सुनो।
यू कैन स्टार्ट।
गुड मॉर्निंग लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन அனைவருக்கும் இனிய காலை வணக்கம் ஆன் பிஹாஃப் ஆஃப் தி டைம்ஸ் ஆஃப் இந்தியா இட் கிவ்ஸ் மீ இம்மென்ஸ் பிளஷர் இன் வெல்கமிங் யூ டு தி வெபினார் பவரிங் growth of MSMEs in Tamil Nadu presented by Tamil Nadu MSME Trade and Investment Promotion Bureau supported by Indian Bank and Ambattur Industrial Trade Manufacturers Association. Our chief guest today is Thiru T.M. Anbarasan, Honorable Minister for Rural Industries, including Cottage Small Industries and Slum Clearance Board, Government of Tamil Nadu. தமிழக அரசு கரோனா தொற்று பரவலை தடுக்க பல வகை முயற்சிகளை எடுத்தது நம் அனைவருக்கும் தெரியும். பதவியேற்று குறுகிய காலத்திற்குள் கரோனா பரவலை திறம்பட கட்டுப்படுத்துவதற்கும் விதமாக பல்வேறு நடவடிக்கை எடுத்ததற்கும் தமிழக மக்களின் சார்பாக எங்களின் நெஞ்சார்ந்த நன்றியை தெரிவிக்கிறோம். எஸ் ஐ வாண்ட் டு சே தேங்க் யூ. திமுக இளைஞர் அணி துணை அமைப்பாளராக அரசியலில் களம் கண்ட மாண்புமிகு அமைச்சர் தாமு அன்பரசன் அவர்கள் தனித்த புகழையும் தகுதி மிகுந்த அடையாளத்தையும் கொண்டவர். குன்றத்தூர் பேரூராட்சி தலைவர், துறைமுக பொறுப்பு கழக உறுப்பினர், கலைஞர் அமைச்சரவையில் தொழிலாளர்கள் நலன் மற்றும் வேலை வாய்ப்புத்துறை அமைச்சர் என தொய்வின்றி மக்களுக்காக சேவை செய்து கொண்டிருக்கும் பண்பான மனிதர். அமைச்சர் மாண்புமிகு தாமு அன்பரசன் அவர்கள் காஞ்சி மாவட்ட மக்களால் கவரப்படுபவர். இதற்கு மூல காரணம் இவர் பதவியில் இருந்தாலும் சரி இல்லை என்றாலும் சரி மக்களோடு மக்களாக ஒன்றி அவர் தம் குறைகள் கேட்டு பூர்த்தி செய்பவர். எளிமையான மக்கள் அனைவரையும் அவர் சந்திக்கலாம். அவர் வீடு ஒரு சிறந்த வீடு. மக்கள் பணியே மகேசன் பணி என்பதற்கு முன் உதாரணமாக விளங்கக்கூடிய அன்பின் வடிவம் இவர். வேலையற்ற இதயங்களில் விபரீத எண்ணங்கள் புகுதிடும் என்று அன்றே அறிஞர் அண்ணா சொன்னார். அதை என்றென்றும் நிறைவேற்றும் வகையில் தகுதி உள்ள இளைஞர் பலருக்கு வேலை வாய்ப்பை ஏற்படுத்தி கொண்டிருப்பார். பன்னாட்டு நிறுவனங்கள் மூலமாக ஏராளமான வேலை வாய்ப்புகள் உண்டாக்கியுள்ளார். தேயிலை தோட்ட தொழிலாளர்களுக்கு பஞ்சாலை தொழிலாளர்களுக்கு குறைந்தபட்ச கூலி நிர்ணயம் செய்ததும் இந்தியாவை திரும்பி பார்க்கும் வகையில் தமிழகத்தில் தொழில்துறை வளர்ச்சியை இவர் உருவாக்கியது வரலாற்றில் ஒரு மைல்கல் நிகழ்வாகும். நமது சென்னை நகரை சுங்கார சென்னையாக மாற்ற மேம்பால திட்டம், குடிநீர் வசதி திட்டம், உள்கட்ட அமைப்பு வசதிகள் என பல ஏற்படுத்தி கொடுத்துள்ளார். கரோனா பரவலை தடுக்க சிறப்பாக செயலாற்றும் அமைச்சர்களை முதல்வர் தேர்ந்தெடுத்தார். அதில் தாமு அன்பரசன் ஒருவர். கொரோனா நோயாளிகளுக்காக தற்காலிகமாக படுக்கை வசதி, குடிசை வாழ் மக்களுக்கு தடுப்பூசி என மக்கள் நலனே முக்கியம் என்று தன்னுயிர் பாதுகாப்பை கூட கருதாத மக்களுக்காக ஓடி ஓடி உழைத்துக் கொண்டிருப்பவர். கொரோனா பெருந்தொற்று காலத்தில் தொழில் முனைவோர் குறைகளை நிவர்த்தி செய்து தொழில்துறையில் தமிழகம் முதன்மை மாநிலமாக திகழ ஓயாது உழைத்து வருபவர். சுயமாக தொழில் வாய்ப்பு ஏற்படுத்தி கொடுக்கும் MSME துறையின் அமைச்சராக நெருக்கடியான கொரோனா காலகட்டத்தில் சிறு குறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர வியாபாரிகளுக்கு கை கொடுக்கும் திட்டங்கள் பல அறிவித்துள்ளார். தி டைம்ஸ் ஆஃப் இந்தியா குழுமம் மற்றும் நேயர்கள் சார்பாக தமிழ்நாட்டின் சிறு குறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழில் முனைவோர் வளர்ச்சி மேம்படுத்தல் வெபினாருக்கு நமது தொழில்துறை அமைச்சரான மாண்புமிகு தாமு அன்பரசன் அவர்களை தி டைம்ஸ் ஆஃப் இந்தியா குழுமம் வரவேற்பதில் பெருமை கொள்கிறது. இப்பொழுது மாண்புமிகு அமைச்சர் அவர்களை சிறப்புரையாற்றும் பணிவன்போடு கேட்டுக்கொள்கிறேன்.
டைம்ஸ் ஆஃப் இந்தியா ஆங்கில தமிழ் நாளிதழ் சார்பில் குறு சிறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் தினத்தை ஒட்டி தமிழ்நாட்டில் உள்ள குறு சிறு நடுத்தர தொழில் முனைவர்களின் வளர்ச்சியை மேம்படுத்துதல் என்ற தலைப்பில் காணொலி காட்சி வாயிலாக நடைபெறும் சிறப்பு நிகழ்ச்சியில் பங்கேற்று நம் அனைவரையும் அன்போடு வரவேற்று தொடக்க உரை ஆற்றிய சனா அவர்களே, இந்த நிகழ்ச்சியை சிறப்பான முறையில் தொகுத்து வழங்கிக் கொண்டிருக்கும் எக்கனாமிக்ஸ் டைம்ஸ் நாளிதழினுடைய மூத்த ஆசிரியர் மரியாதைக்குரிய அகிலேஷ் பட்டாச்சாரியா அவர்களே, இக்கூட்டத்தில் பங்கேற்று சிறப்பித்துள்ள தென்னிந்திய வர்த்தக சபையினுடைய தலைவர் மரியாதைக்குரிய ஏஆர்ஆர் எம் அருண் அவர்களே, கோவை ஒடிசா தலைவர் திரு எம் பி ரமேஷ் பாபு அவர்களே, அம்பத்தூர் தொழிற்பேட்டை உற்பத்தியாளர்கள் சங்க தலைவர் திரு பாலச்சந்திரன் அவர்களே, இந்தியன் வங்கியினுடைய குறு சிறு நடுத்தர தொழில்கள் பிரிவு பொது மேலாளர் கே சுதாகர் ராவ் அவர்களே, மற்றும் குறு சிறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்களின் அதிபர்களே, இறுதியாக நன்றி உரையாற்ற உள்ள டைம்ஸ் ஆஃப் இந்தியா சென்னை பதிப்பு பொது மேலாளர் திரு சிவ மெய்யப்பன் அவர்களே, அனைவருக்கும் வணக்கம். உலகளாவிய பொருளாதார வளர்ச்சியில் பெரும் பங்காற்றும் குறு சிறு நடுத்தர நிறுவனங்களின் முக்கியத்துவத்தை அங்கீகரிக்கும் வகையில் ஐக்கிய நாடுகள் சபை தொழில் முனைவோருக்கு விழிப்புணர்வை ஏற்படுத்துவதற்காக ஜூன் 27 தேதியை குறு சிறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் தினமாக அறிவித்து 2017 ஆண்டிலிருந்து ஆண்டுதோறும் இத்தினத்தை மகிழ்ச்சியோடு நாம் கொண்டாடிக்கொண்டிருக்கிறோம். தமிழ்நாட்டில் உள்ள குறு சிறு நடுத்தர தொழில் முனைவர்களின் வளர்ச்சியை மேம்படுத்தல் என்ற தலைப்பின் கீழ் டைம்ஸ் ஆஃப் இந்தியா ஆங்கில நாளிதழில் காணொலி காட்சியின் வாயிலாக நடைபெறும் இந்த சிறப்பு நிகழ்ச்சியில் உங்களோடு இணைந்து பங்கேற்று உரையாற்றும் நல்வாய்ப்பை அளித்த டைம்ஸ் ஆஃப் இந்தியா ஆங்கில தமிழ்நாடு நிறுவனத்திற்கு எனது இதயம் கலந்த நன்றியை இந்த நேரத்தை நான் தெரிவித்துக் கொள்ள கடமைப்பட்டிருக்கிறேன். இந்திய திருநாட்டின் பொருளாதாரத்தை மற்றும் சமூக மேம்பாட்டிற்கு பெரிதும் உதவும் வகையில் குறைந்த முதலீட்டில் குறு சிறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் தொழில் முனைவர்களை உருவாக்கி பெருந்தொழிற்சாலைகளுக்கு துணை நின்று தொழில் வளர்ச்சிக்கு பெரிதும் உதவுகிறது. தமிழ்நாட்டில் விவசாயத்திற்கு அடுத்தபடியாக குறு சிறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழில்துறை பொருளாதார வளர்ச்சியில் பெரும் பங்கு வகித்து வருகின்றது. தமிழகத்தில் அதிகபட்ச வேலை வாய்ப்புகளை உருவாக்கக்கூடிய முக்கிய துறையாகும். இந்தியாவில் உத்தரப்பிரதேசம் மற்றும் தெற்கு வங்காளத்திற்கு அடுத்தபடியாக தமிழகத்தில் மொத்தம் 23,60,000 தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள், 2,73,000 கோடி முதலீட்டில் தொடங்கப்பட்டு 1,52,00,000 பேருக்கு வேலை வாய்ப்புகள் அளிக்கப்பட்டு வருகிறது. ஆக இந்த நிலையில் தமிழகம் இன்றைக்கு 3வது மாநிலமாக திகழ்கிறது. நேற்றைக்கு நான் சொன்னதை போல தமிழகத்தை முதல் மாநிலம் ஆக்குவதே திராவிட முன்னேற்ற கழக அரசின் கொள்கை முழக்கமாக விளங்குகிறது என்பதை நான் மகிழ்ச்சியோடு தெரிவித்திருக்கிறேன். நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் தின நாளில் உறுதியாக விரும்புகிறேன். மேலும் தமிழகம் ஜவுளி ஆயத்த ஆடைகள் பொறியியல் பொருட்கள் தானியங்கி வாகன உதவி வாங்கல் உற்பத்தி முக்கிய இடம் வகிக்கிறது. தமிழகத்தில் உள்ள இளைஞர்களை தொழில் முனைவர்களாக உருவாக்க தமிழ்நாடு அரசு 3 வகையான மானியத்துடன் கூடிய கடன் திட்டங்களை செயல்படுத்தி வருகிறது. முதல் தலைமுறை தொழில் முனைவர்களை ஊக்குவித்து 5 கோடி கடன் வழங்க திட்டத்தையும், வேலையில்லா இளைஞர்களுக்கு வேலை வாய்ப்பு உருவாக்கும் திட்டம் மற்றும் பிரதமரின் வேலை வாய்ப்பு உருவாக்கும் திட்டத்திற்கு ₹25,00,000 வரை கடன் வழங்கும் திட்டத்தையும் தமிழக அரசு சிறப்பான முறையில் செயல்படுத்தி ஒவ்வொரு ஆண்டும் 8,000 மேற்பட்ட புதிய தொழில் முனைவர்களை இன்றைக்கு உருவாக்கி கொண்டிருக்கிறது என்பதை நான் தெரிவித்திருக்கிறேன். தமிழ்நாட்டின் குறு சிறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் பணியாற்றி வரும் சூழ்நிலை உள்ளிட்ட எத்தகைய சவால்களையும் போட்டி சூழலையும் எதிர்கொள்ளும் வகையில் தொடர்ந்து நீடித்த நிலையான வளர்ச்சியை பெறுவதற்கு ஏதுவான வகையிலும் தமிழ்நாடு அரசு பல்வேறு சிறப்பு திட்டங்களை மாண்பு தமிழக முதல்வர் தளபதி அவருடைய தளபதி அவர்கள் உருவாக்கி தந்துள்ளார்கள். நலிவடைந்து கொண்டிருக்கிற ஆயிரக்கணக்கான சிறு குறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழில் திருநாட்டின் பிரச்சனைகளை உரிய முறையில் தீர்ப்பதற்கு வசதியாக அரசு துறைகள், நிதி நிறுவனங்கள், தொழில்துறை ஆகியவற்றின் பிரதிநிதிகள் அடங்கிய குழு ஒன்றை உருவாக்கி அக்குழுவின் பரிந்துரைகளை பற்றி தொழில் நிறுவனங்களை நலிவிடிருந்து மீட்க உரிய நடவடிக்கை எடுக்கப்பட்டு வருகிறது என்பதை தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கிறேன். தமிழ்நாடு முதல்வர் அவர்களின் அறிவுறுத்தலின்படி தமிழ்நாடு முழுவதும் ஒரே சீரான தொழில் வளர்ச்சியை உருவாக்க அனைத்து மாவட்டங்களிலும் பின்தங்கிய பகுதிகளில் சிட்கோ நிறுவனம் மூலம் தொழிற்பட்டியல் உருவாக்கப்படும். தற்போது கொரோனா பெருந்தொற்று பரவல் உலகமே பேரழிவு சூழலில் சிக்கி தவிக்கிறது. தமிழ்நாட்டில் கொரோனா பரவலை கட்டுப்படுத்தி உலக தமிழக மக்களின் உயிரை காத்திடும் வகையில் மாண்புமிகு தமிழக முதல்வர் தளபதி அவர்கள் இரவு பகல் பாராமல் கடுமையாக உழைத்ததன் காரணமாக தமிழகத்தில் தற்போது நோய் தொற்று வருவாக குறைந்திருக்கிறது. எனினும் தமிழகத்தில் கொரோனா தொற்று காரணமாக நீடிக்கப்பட்ட ஊரடங்கினால் குறு சிறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் நிதி நெருக்கடி, பெருமளவு தொழிலாளர்கள் வெளியேறியதால் தொழிலாளர் பற்றாக்குறை, குறைந்த கொள்முதல், அதிக உற்பத்தி செலவுகள் ஆகியவற்றினால் பெரிதும் பாதிக்கப்பட்டுள்ளது. இப்பாதிப்பிலிருந்து தமிழகத்தை குறு சிறு நடுத்தர தொழில்களை மீட்டெடுக்க தமிழக முதல்வர் தளபதி அவர்களின் தலைமையிலான புதிய அரசு ஒரு செயல் திட்டத்தை வகுக்க உள்ளது. இத்திட்டப்படி தொழில் நிறுவனங்களை புனரமைத்தல், இழக்கப்பட்டுள்ள வேலைவாய்ப்பை மீட்டு புதிய வேலைவாய்ப்பை உருவாக்குதல், தொழில்நுட்பத்தை மேம்படுத்துதல், மின்னணு முறையை கடைபிடித்தல் ஆகியவற்றில் தீவிர கவனம் செலுத்தி இத்துறையை முதன்மை துறையாக மாற்றி அமைப்போம் என உறுதி கூறுகிறேன். கொரோனாவால் பாதிக்கப்பட்டுள்ள சிறு குறு நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் உடனடியாக பயன்பெறும் வகையில் பல்வேறு சலுகைகளை அறிவித்துள்ளார்கள். குறிப்பாக சிறு குறு நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்களுக்கு முதலீட்டு மானியம் வழங்க இந்த ஆண்டு அந்த நிதியாண்டில் 280 கோடி ரூபாய் ஒதுக்கப்பட்டு அதில் 60% தொகையான ₹168 கோடி விடுவிக்க அரசாணை வெளியிட்டு இன்று வரை 1399 தொழில் நிறுவனங்களுக்கு 113 கோடி ரூபாய் நிதி பட்வாடா செய்யப்பட்டுள்ளது என்பதை நான் தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கிறேன். இத்தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் வங்கியிடம் இருந்து கடன் உதவி பெறும்போது செலுத்த வேண்டிய முத்திரைத்தாள் பதிவு கட்டணம் செலுத்துவதிலிருந்து டிசம்பர் மாதம் வரை விலக்கு விதிக்கப்பட்டுள்ளது. சிட்கோ நிறுவனத்துக்கு செலுத்த வேண்டிய மனை விலை தவணை தொகை வாடகை செலுத்துவதற்கு மேலும் 6 மாத காலம் அவகாசம் நீட்டிக்கப்பட்டுள்ளது. இத்தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் மாசு கட்டுப்பாடு வாரியம், நீரமைப்பு துறை, தொழிலாளர் துறை, வணிக உரிமம் உள்ளிட்ட அனைத்து உரிமைகளை புதுப்பிக்க டிசம்பர் மாதம் வரை நீட்டிக்கப்பட்டுள்ளது. இந்நிறுவனங்களில் பணிபுரியும் பணியாளர்கள் செலுத்த வேண்டிய தொழில் வரியை செலுத்த 3 மாத காலம் அவகாசம் வழங்கப்பட்டுள்ளது. ஆக இப்படி 14 பல்வேறு சலுகைகளை தமிழக முதல்வர் அவர்கள் அறிவித்திருக்கிறார்கள் என்பதை இந்த நேரத்தில் நான் தெரிவித்துக் கொள்ள கடமைப்பட்டிருக்கிறேன். தமிழகத்தில் உள்ள குறு சிறு மற்றும் நடுத்தர தொழிற்சாலைகளை நலிந்து போகாமல் பாதுகாக்க இந்த சலுகையின் மூலமாக நடவடிக்கை எடுத்துள்ளார்கள் என்பதையும் நான் நினைவுபடுத்த விரும்புகிறேன். தமிழ்நாட்டில் தொழில் பொருளாதாரத்தில் முதுகெலும்பாக விளங்கும் சிறு குறு நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்கள் கொரோனா தொற்று காரணமாக கடுமையாக பாதிக்கப்பட்டு உள்ள நிலையில் அந்நிறுவனங்களை மீட்டெடுக்க மத்திய அரசு 20% பிழையில்லா அவசர கால கூடுதல் கடன் திட்டத்தை செயல்படுத்தி வருகிறது. இத்திட்டத்தின் கீழ் இந்த குறு சிறு நடுத்தர தொழில் நிறுவனங்களுக்கு அதிக அளவில் கடன் வழங்க மாண்புமிகு தமிழக நிதியமைச்சர் அவர்கள் சிறப்பு வங்கியாளர்கள் கூட்டத்தை கூட்டி வங்கியாளர்களை அறிவித்துள்ளார். இறுதியாக இந்த நாட்டின் இளைஞர்கள் அது இறுதியாக நான் ஒன்று சொல்ல விரும்புவது படித்த இளைஞர்கள் நேராக வேலைக்கு போகணும்னு நினைக்கிறாங்க. அந்த இளைஞர்கள் தானாக தொழில் தொடங்கி பல இளைஞர்களுக்கு வேலை வாய்ப்பு உருவாக்க வேண்டும் எண்ணத்தில் படித்து விட்டு வேலை என்று தேடி செல்லாமல் தொழில்களை தொடங்க முன்வாருங்கள் என்று அன்புடன் அழைக்கிறேன். அத்துடன் புதிய தொழில் கண்டுபிடிப்புகளை கண்டுபிடித்து தமிழகத்தின் தொழில் வளர்ச்சிக்கு உறுதியாக இருந்து இந்த இனிய நாளில் அனைத்து குறு சிறு தொழில் நிறுவனங்களுக்கும் எனது இதயம் கலந்த நல்வாழ்த்துக்களை தெரிவித்து இந்த நிகழ்ச்சியை மிகச்சிறப்பாக ஏற்பாடு செய்து தந்திருக்கிற நம்முடைய டைம்ஸ் ஆஃப் இந்தியா நிறுவனத்திற்கும் நன்றி சொல்லி விடைபெறுகிறேன். நன்றி, வணக்கம்.
நன்றி ஐயா. தமிழகம் முழுவதும் தொழில்துறையில் சீரான வளர்ச்சியை எட்டிவிட முடியும் என்று நம்பிக்கை கொடுத்ததற்கு நன்றி. புதிய உதயம் இனிதே துவங்க வாழ்த்துக்கள். A quick look at some key points from Honorable Minister's speech. There have been a slew of subsidies and schemes announced to help the MSME sector bounce back. The Honorable Chief Minister had announced these a while ago. He said the state government would immediately release 60%, that is 168 crores of the 280 crore sanction for granting capital subsidies to these units this fiscal. All eligible units would get the capital subsidy. The government has also extended the timeline for registration of the memorandum of deposit without penalty till December to help these units get bank loans. The window was earlier extended until March this year. Also, the validity of statutory licenses, including those from the Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board and the Departments of Fire, Labor and Industrial Safety that were to expire between May and September this year, would be extended till December. To create entrepreneurs in Tamil Nadu, different schemes have been announced. I'm just going to quickly talk to you about the NEED scheme. The youth will be given entrepreneurship development program training, assisted to prepare their business plans, and of course, help them tie up with financial institutions so as to set up manufacturing and service ventures. This is exclusive for the first generation entrepreneurs who can avail up to 5 crores as loans. Of course, industrial estates to come up mostly in backward districts with the help of CIDCO. He's also encouraged youngsters to say, hey, you know what, don't just join jobs, but also take up entrepreneurship. And most importantly, this government is tirelessly working to make Tamil Nadu number one in all aspects. Thank you so much, sir. Also, ladies and gentlemen, if you're just about joining us, today we are going to be focusing on something very special. Our discussion today will look at a sector that has been, without any doubt, the engine of our growth and plays an important role in the equitable economic development of our country. On behalf of the Times of India, it gives me immense pleasure in welcoming you to the webinar, Powering Growth of MSMEs in Tamil Nadu, presented by Tamil Nadu MSME Trade and Investment Promotion Bureau, supported by Indian Bank and Ambattur Industrial Estate Manufacturers Association. And of course, this session is going to be moderated today by Mr. Alokesh Bhattacharya, Senior Editor, The Economic Times. Mr. Alokesh heads the editorial content for E.T. Graysill, the branded content powerhouse of The Economic Times. His leadership has seen E.T. Graysill's digital evolution leading to tremendous success. As founder editor, he has been at the heart of highly acclaimed initiatives such as the E.T. Family Business Awards, E.T. Innovation Awards, E.T. Best Boards, and E.T. Tamil Nadu Corporate Awards. As a moderator, he engages the top newsmakers, politicians, and pioneers in business and economics in honest conversations. With close to 18 years of experience, the seasoned journalist has held leadership positions in core editorial roles in Business Today, Business World, and Smart Inc. So, it's over to you.
Thank you very much, Sanbar. It's wonderful. Thank you for the very kind introduction. And very, very warm thanks to the Honorable Minister Anbarasan for giving us an outline of what the government is planning to do for MSMEs in the state. It's really heartening to know that so many initiatives are being planned. And I'm sure some of them will really help the MSMEs come out of the crisis today. And it's a great day actually to have a discussion on MSMEs in Tamil Nadu. And it is my privilege to moderate this panel discussion along with my colleague Pallavi.
Hello everyone, it's great to be here. I'm Pallavi Chakravarti, Senior Features Editor of the Economic Times. From a business and economy point of view, MSMEs have faced the brunt of the impact of COVID-19 across both the waves. And the lockdowns in particular have created absolute havoc.
Yes, indeed. The lockdowns have actually been more of the black swan event, right, than the COVID as such. But it has been a really difficult time. And Tamil Nadu, which has more than 5 million small enterprises, it has the third highest number of MSMEs in India. They produce more than 6,000 different products for domestic and international markets. And they also provide a very strong vendor base to the large industries in the state, of which there are many.
Absolutely. With more than 5 million enterprises as the third highest number of MSMEs in India, these MSMEs produce over 6,000 different products for both domestic and international markets, and also provide a very strong vendor base to the large industries in the state.
So, you know, the lockdown has been quite bad news for the MSMEs across the country. And given that their share of Indian GDP is almost 29%, you know, almost one third of a country's growth engine getting knocked out cannot be good. So in this context, I'm really looking forward to today's discussion on powering growth of MSMEs in Tamil Nadu. We'll hopefully come up with some real life solutions today to the challenges that MSMEs face in the state. So let us begin with introducing the panel to you first. We have with us Mr. ARRM Arun, President of the Southern India Chamber of Commerce and Industry. We have Mr. M.V. Ramesh Babu, is the President of the Coimbatore District Small Scale Industries Association, or CODISIA.
We also have Mr. M. Balachandran, President, Ambattur Industrial Estate Manufacturers Association, IMA. Mr. K. Sudhakar Rao, General Manager, MSME Indian Bank. Let us now dive straight into the discussion. I'll first invite all our panelists to give short opening thoughts on the subject. We will start with Mr. Arun of SICKI, and I hope that the discussion is as breezy as the weather here in Bangalore, though I'm sure Alokesh would like some hot sparks like the heat in Delhi. Over to you, Mr. Arun.
Love to have some Bangalore weather in Delhi. Mr. Arun.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes. Please carry on.
Very good morning to all of you. On behalf of the Southern India Chamber of Commerce and Industry, SICKI, big vanakkam to each one of you. I would like to thank Times of India as well as Mr. Siva Meyyappan for having invited me today. Mr. Alokesh, certainly MSMEs are the mainstay of any economy, whether it's a developing economy or a developed economy. And it's also a mainstay in India, with Tamil Nadu being among the largest, having the largest number of MSMEs in our country. Certainly glad to be addressing you on the occasion of MSME Day and sharing paths to powering growth of our own MSMEs in Tamil Nadu. In my opening remarks, I'd like to briefly address 5 points, and we can expand upon it later as necessary. The first point is COVID. We are here today primarily due to the devastation that COVID has caused. So I'd like to address it very briefly. Would like to appreciate the government of Tamil Nadu for ensuring positive steps in this fight against COVID. They have come up with a war room ever since this new government took place. This war room has now turned into a nerve center and have been making very bold decisions, including about the lockdown, which has been very important. We have to understand that COVID is going to be staying with us for some time to come. It's not going to go away anytime soon. And towards that, it's very important to reiterate 3 points. Number one is to ensure the vaccinations among each one of us, continue to ensure the precautions as well. And thirdly, important to be able to boost up the immunity among each one of us so that we can sustain in business. Because if we don't have health, we don't have business. Most importantly, businesses need to understand that survival first. We have to do whatever we need to do to survive, ethically, of course, and we have to wait for growth. We have to understand that even if we are ready to sell, there should be others who are ready to buy. Secondly, a few points about SICKI. We are encouraged about the government of Tamil Nadu's positive industry approach with the focused appointments to start with, both at the ministerial level as well as the bureaucrat level. Last month, as I was mentioning during the earlier part of our conversation today, SICKI had conducted a program targeting MSMEs, where we submitted an immediate term 9-point agenda and a long-term 12-point agenda. One of the areas that we have identified within SICKI is that of the aerospace and defense industry, which could perhaps be a sunrise industry for MSMEs. I'd like to share about that more so as we move along. Another area that SICKI has been working on with the government is that of the MSME financial clinics, which of course has been of good value. I'd like to share on that as well as we move along. The third area that I'd like to talk about is that of the government. Certainly from a government of Tamil Nadu standpoint, we've identified 9 areas that will be good to speak about. and I can expand upon it later, but I'd list the 9 areas for your reference. First of all, having an MSME sustenance war room. Secondly, facilitating loans. Thirdly, getting large companies to be able to support. Fourth, ensuring the required self-sufficiency within our economy. Next, encouraging cottage industries among our fold. Factories Act can definitely be re-looked at. We have to look at the manpower, whether it is reducing manpower or training manpower or even the migrant manpower. EB concessions are something to be looked at, which other states are doing so. And of course, deferring property tax as well would be some of the things that the government of Tamil Nadu can look at. Looking at it from the government of India standpoint, definitely IT refunds, income tax refunds are not happening across the board. There's still room for improvement. There are a few points on the GST front that I'd like to talk about. Development financing was a thing of the past and now it's gone. I think that has to be brought back. And certainly we need to look at compliances that private limited companies have to be subject to, especially because MSMEs are all private limited companies. The fourth area is that of banking, which is very, very important. When we look at our MSMEs today, quite a lot of them have had to incur salaries, expenses, but have not been able to receive the respective income. And this has hence resulted in weak cash flows, no or insufficient working capital, and of course, losses. Due to this, and as per all the RBI guidelines that are there, banks are perhaps taking a safeguard under that and not extending these loans, citing losses and poor credit scores of these companies. So while the RBI has come out in support of MSMEs and industry at large, especially during this time, what the RBI suggested perhaps is not following through to the extent to which it needs to. Restructuring is definitely not moving as fast. And some of the banking policies as well, we find to be restrictive, whether it is working capital or new loans, we have to be able to ensure that we are able to follow through. Last, looking at it from the business's standpoint itself, 4 points that I'd like to just go through very quickly. One is businesses have to understand that life is a continuous learning process, and I'd like to share about that. Secondly, businesses have to evolve. Businesses have to remain relevant in order to be able to survive. Third, we have to make sure that we are embracing technology. Those who have not have to be able to do it as fast as they can in order to ensure their survival. And finally, businesses have to be able to manage their financials better, whether it is reducing cost or ensuring cash flows or addressing the receivable cycle. So again, during my opening speech, I just wanted to lay out all these points, and I'll be glad to go into each one of these as we move along. Over to you, Alokesh.
Thank you, Mr. Arun. In fact, you've quite succinctly outlined several points that we are going to discuss today, and it's very good to have this kind of opening statement from you. It gives us a lot of things, you know, the fact that aerospace and defense you have outlined as, you know, the possible sunrise industries for MSMEs, I think that's a positive thing, apart from the fact that there are other challenges which we will address as we go on. I would now like to come to Mr. Balachandran for his opening thoughts. Mr. Balachandran. You're on mute, sir.
Good morning to you all.
Good morning.
Thank you. Thank you, Times of India. Thank you, Mr. Alokesh, for having organized this webinar. I, on behalf of IIMA and myself, are glad to be in this webinar. And today, I thank the Honorable Minister for his opening remarks. It gives us a lot of assurance that the government is keen to do what it says. And it has not been just a question of announcing a lot of policies that we could see when within 3 days of taking over the new government, we were all called for a meeting, and some of the suggestions that we made were immediately I responded to, especially for the subsidy. I would like to take 2 minutes on this. The subsidy was not being given to most units because they had to show a 25% increase in turnover, apart from 25% increase in the assets. And many companies could not satisfy the second condition, and IIMA took it up even last year when Madam Anujaj was the Director of Industries and Commerce. In the height of pandemic, she took it up with the government and gave the relief for 2021. So we found that many companies were probably suffering because of 1920 expansion. So that the government immediately addressed when we met them on the 8th of May, and immediately passed an order. That's how this 280 crores and this 168 crores immediate relief came. So it was a big relief for companies which had already taken 20% of the additional limits from the banks and were a little finding it difficult to manage the second pandemic. And I thank my co-panelists who are here with me today, Mr. Arun of President SICCI, Mr. Ramesh Babu, President Codicia, Mr. Sudhakar Rao of Indian Bank, and we hope we have a very fruitful discussion. As far as my points are concerned, I feel there are certain things that need to be addressed when we want to learn from this new normal. Many companies are finding it easy to restart, but they are not able to get the business now because the government has been a little more relaxed this time, allowed the companies to start. So there are certain issues that need to be addressed to make it much easier for them to restart. And we would like to address those points. And certain issues like when I am talking about industry, I would like to talk about micro and small, because the medium, the new definition covers 50 crores and 250 crore turnover, which I feel are really large companies. So they don't need that sort of support. So when we look at the micro, I feel that we need to look at this. GI tag is being touted as a big thing, but the GI tag doesn't by itself get the business. We need to do a complete revamp of the technology of these companies which are into this traditional manufacturing, import the technology from these countries, from Southeast Asian countries, because ultimately what sells is what the market wants, and the market can see what is available on the net. So I need to talk a little more on those things. As far as this interpretation of laws are concerned, I think there is a lot of divergence in the interpretation of laws. And MSMEs don't have the time to handle so many laws. There is, for example, a double licensing. You need to take a license from the municipal corporation. You need to take a license from the inspector of factories. So these are some of the, like, the type of calculation for your gross fixed assets under the Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board. There is a lot of interpretations, and it makes it difficult for companies to comply with the laws. And we feel that these are all the issues that need to be addressed in a greater detail. And similarly, when we look at artificial intelligence and IoT, it can substantially alter the way the small business can be done. But people don't have a clue in the MSME what exactly that can be bought and used. So I feel the government should get involved in that, talk to the experts, and make a small package that can be affordable for many companies. What we are looking at this as a Tally ERP, not a SAP ERP. That's what I think should be the ultimate goal. And the other issue is the first and second wave has created a lot of hardship for the companies. We would like to talk about those things. So as we go, I think we will expand on this. So I leave the floor open for my co-panelists. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ramesh Babu. Some very pertinent points. And I think we have questions for you on technology, which we feel it's very, very important for the MSMEs to kind of embrace. We'll now go to Mr. Ramesh Babu. Thank you, Mr. Balachandran. We'll now go to Mr. Ramesh Babu. Please, sir, your opening comments.
Yeah. Good morning to one and all present here. First and foremost, I would like to congratulate the Tamil Nadu government headed by M.K. Stalin, Honorable Chief Minister, and Mr. Anbarasan, Minister for MSME, who is present here today now. I would like to convey my sincere thanks our Honorable Chief Minister and all ministers, Government of Tamil Nadu, for calling us for the meeting immediately on the third day from the date of taking charge as Honorable Ministers, and for giving us an opportunity to put forward the challenges faced by the MSMEs. I wish to thank through V. Arun Roy, IAS Secretary, MSME Department, and Trimati Shiji Thomas, IAS Industries Commissioner and Director of Industries, for having organized a series of meetings with us to know the problems of MSMEs, and for their excellent and continuous support to the MSMEs. I immensely thank Times of India for organizing this program on this MSME Day. And my wishes to fellow MSME fraternity for this MSME Day. MSMEs are the important sector and the backbone of Indian economy. MSMEs contribute immensely to the country's socio-economic development. MSME sector has emerged as a highly vibrant sector of the Indian economy over the last 5 decades. MSMEs contributes about 30% of GDP and 48% of exports, and direct employment of 12 crores. On this note, I'd like to slightly brief on Odisha's contribution to MSMEs. We have around 6,000 members in our association. We at Odisha represent the MSMEs problems to the concerned ministries both in the central and state level. We conduct guidance sale on every Friday for the new and existing entrepreneurs. Odisha, the expert in expressions, is synonymous with the world-class trade fairs since 1988. The trade fairs of Odisha is Intech, Agri-Intech, Build-Intech, Electro-Intech, and Subcon, etc., which is not only showcase the latest technologies in the respective fields, but also act as a catalyst for industrial growth. The objective of these exhibitions is to give maximum exposure to the entrepreneurs as well as the general public and open new avenues for business opportunities. Odisha has developed two state-of-the-art industrial parks. These industrial parks are coming up in a total area of 375 acres. About 320 MSMEs are setting shops in these two industrial parks with an investment of around 3,000 crores. These industries will provide direct employment to about 10,000 people and indirectly generate around 20,000 people. Odisha has initiated the process of developing a skill development center in the name of Odisha Center of Excellence. And Odisha is one of the five nodal points of the Southern Corridor identified for the development of defense sector. Odisha Defense Innovation and Replication Center is the first defense innovation hub to be set up in India. The center has been created with a vision to develop the Coimbatore region into a leading defense manufacturing hub within the next 10 years. On this MSME day, I would like to emphasize that a special economic zone for electronic manufacturing to be created, wherein we can save a lot of foreign exchange. Also, EV manufacturing and defense manufacturing should be concentrated for future development. Here I'd like to close my speech. For panel discussion, we will discuss the problems of MSMEs. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ramesh Babu, for those initial thoughts and the great work that Odisha is doing. You're really encouraged. And yes, exhibitions are a great way of getting people to know about different brands and also in terms of getting their products sold. So I'm hoping that the exhibition in India, the scale of exhibitions in India is rather low at this point, right, compared to Europe and other places. So hopefully, with your efforts and efforts of other parts of the country, we will see those scale up and help MSMEs more. I'll come to Mr. Sudhakar Rao of Indian Bank. Mr. Rao, your opening thoughts. There have already been, Mr. Arun has already said a few comments about banking and banks and RBI, but your opening thoughts before we come to those specific issues.
Sure. Thank you. First of all, congratulations to all the MSMEs on the eve of MSME Day. See, there are many other industries are there, but MSMEs, we will be talking largely by all central government, state government, and all the stakeholders. The reason behind is MSMEs contribute 29% of Indian GDP. Employ more than 11 crore, and 6.3 crore enterprises are there. And their contribution to exports is immense, and it is growing year after year. Because of all these reasons, International MSME Day has been declared by the United Nations. And yesterday, that is 27th June, is the International MSME Day. And really, we are fortunate that today this conference has been organized by Times of India and Tamil Nadu state government, and all the MSME associations are there. And the theme of this year, International MSME Day, is Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs. So really, coming back to MSMEs, see, government of India is doing a lot of benefits, a lot of schemes they have announced. Tamil Nadu state government also announced a lot of schemes, capital subsidies. And banks also, of course, Indian Bank is the forerunner, particularly in Tamil Nadu. So we are also implementing a lot of schemes. See, just a few words about the few schemes about the government of India. The important thing is the definition of the MSME has been leveraged now, the revised definition. So more and more MSMEs will be qualify for this decision, definition. Then second is interest subvention. They have announced 2% interest subvention is there. Then Champions Portal recently launched by Government of India. So it will be resolving a lot of issues. There is one single portal which will address all the issues of the MSMEs. Then launch of PSB 59 portal is there. Then Trends platform is there. That's an excellent solution for the receivables. Recently, the last year, year after year also, the number of bills being discounted on Trends platform is increasing like anything. That's a very successful platform, I can say. Then coming to the state government support. Just now we had the Honorable Minister, sir. So capital subsidies have been announced. And then last year, I remember still, they have reduced drastically the stamp duty for MSMEs. Whenever the MSMEs are taking loans and all, some stamp duty is involved. So they have reduced drastically the stamp duty also to large extent to micro and small industries. And like that, many more SOPs are being announced by the state government. And coming to the Indian Bank, we are having a lot number of products, MSME products are there for financing. And a few I will just tell. One is the cash flow based financing we have recently started. Just it is based on the turnover, GST turnover, and without insisting any balance sheet and all. And then in the Surya Shakti, see, this is the order of the day. Now, entire textile industry, particularly the Coimbatore, Tirupur, and all these. So they are having a huge electricity bill is being paid by them. There is a lot of requirement of consumption of electricity. You know. So to support them, we have given the product called the Surya Shakti. That is, they can own, they can purchase the solar panels. They can establish the solar panels and thereby they can reduce the electricity bill. That whatever they are paying towards the EB, that can be paid to the bank and thereby they become the owners of the all the entire the solar equipment. So 25 years, the life of the solar equipment. So huge benefit is there for particularly those who are consuming the power in a large way. And then recently we have started the Springboard startups. So it's a very novel, no other bank has started. We are financing the startups. So startup financing is, you know, it is very somewhat to some extent risky. And we have leveraged all our principles also, the procedures also we have leveraged. And we had a tie-up with Indian Institute of Madras Incubation Cell, Institute of Science Bangalore, and TCA, the Chennai Angels, and many more are there. So we are going ahead. That is relevant. And above all, so we were all discussing so many schemes will be available in the banks, but how it will be known to the MSMEs, particularly the micro and small, they may not be having that much financial literacy. So we have started this business mentoring program called MSME Prerna in all the states in vernacular language. In vernacular language, if we give this financial literacy education, how to prepare the balance sheets. What is the importance of the balance sheet? Why we should grow sales and net profit? What are the what is the need of the ratios? And how we can get better rated based on our balance sheets? So thereby we can reduce our cost of credit. So all these things we are imparting through our MSME Prerana scheme in vernacular language. This has been started by Finance Minister Madam Nirmala Sitharaman. And incidentally, today we are starting the same program for Maharashtra state also on the eve of this. So like this, many more supportive measures. Recently, because of the COVID pandemic, really the worst hit was the MSMEs. Absolutely, there is no second opinion in that. So last year also, Government of India has come out as a part of Atmanirbhar package, GECLS, 20% we have given. And now this year also, we thought the small break has come. So we thought everything is over. But now suddenly, the deadly second wave has come. So it was really, the situation was further deteriorated and horrible. And everybody has directly or indirectly were affected by this COVID second wave. And keeping that in view, again, the restructuring package, which was announced by Reserve Bank of India, we are implementing letter and spirit. Not only restructuring and reassessment of working capital also, we have detailed guidelines have been given to field level functionaries. And more powers were given to field level functionaries so that they can quickly address the issues of the MSMEs. So like this, many more, some more issues also there. Yes, as our association's representatives were telling, small issues were there. That will be definitely, we will be also taking up with the Reserve Bank of India as well as with the Government of India so that more and more MSMEs will be benefited. So with this, I just conclude my opening remarks. Thank you once again.
Thank you, Mr. Rao. And in fact, you know, one of the things that you mentioned, cash flow based financing and balance sheet based financing, that's so very important, you know, and your thing about startups, because there is this difference between the startups and the SMEs, right? The startups are all new companies, you know, 2-3 years old. And some of the SMEs are really old, right? 150 years old and 200 years old. And some of them are like 30, 40, 50, 80 years old companies. I have always wondered why the startup model of financing cannot be used for SMEs, because then they get, their startup financing thing is based on future income, right? They practically have no revenue, some of them. Yet they get, millions of dollars in investment. So how can you replicate that in an SME scenario? That possibly is, the balance sheet based and cash flow based financing would be one of the ways, and hopefully we'll find more ways. But thank you all for your opening remarks. It was really wonderful, having all those thoughts in. And my first really question to the group is the question of survival, which we were discussing yesterday also offline. Mr. Arun, you mentioned it, right, that the MSMEs are finding it difficult to survive because primarily of the lockdowns and the other problems brought in by the COVID-19 pandemic. Perhaps you could outline to us a little bit about, we can just have a discussion with the group around what are the primary challenges that MSMEs still face today now that the count of infections is also gradually coming down? And how can they be solved? You want to start, Mr. Arun? Then we'll come to the others.
Thank you, Ms. Avakesh. If I can take a little bit of time, perhaps another 30, 40 seconds, just to understand the enormity of the problem in front of us. We've spoken about, the nearly 7 lakh MSMEs that we have. We perhaps have about 50 lakh companies in the non-registered, unorganized sector who are not coming under this gambit. And if we look at Chennai's 4 districts, we have 70% of the MSMEs here, and they're primarily in the automotive supply chain. Quite a lot of these MSMEs are mostly owner-owned, and they don't have a succession plan. Typically, quite a lot of them come on two-wheelers depend on two-wheelers for coming to the factory or office or whatever it is. Today, the situation is that 60% there's an addition of NPAs in April and May, nearly twice as what it was earlier, to be about 30 to 40% earlier. I'm not sure if the banks understand the enormity of the problem of facing the coming quarters, but there's going to be a lot of NPAs coming along. In fact, I had mentioned lightheartedly during my conversations yesterday that perhaps Mr. Sudhakar Rao is the lone champion into this call, where we have 3 from the association, 1 banker. Perhaps it would have been good to have a few other bankers also so that he doesn't take the load. But certainly, this is not going after Mr. Sudhakar Rao or Indian Bank in particular. This is across banks. How can we expect companies to survive if they are not getting any income during this lockdown period? That's something that the understanding of that has been there to the required extent. I completely agree with you, Mr. Alokesh. How can we talk about startups and new companies coming around without having to talk about the brownfield companies? There are, in fact, in quite a lot of government discussions, we speak about greenfield, we talk about new investments, we talk about FDI. But rarely do we talk about brownfield entities and how do we get brownfield entities to survive, let alone grow. If we don't take care of our own companies today, how are we going to take care of the greenfields today when it comes time for tomorrow? This is something that we really need to see. what is paying the MSMEs today, what is really hurting them, is the absence of the much needed working capital. It's not equity capital, it's not capital subsidy, it is purely working capital. So when you don't have income coming in, but you still have to pay salaries, you're not able to reduce because of government policies and the Factory Act being that way. You're not able to reduce your EV cost because of fixed charges and so on. You have to necessarily incur these expenditures. How are you going to be able to survive if you don't have the working capital? Purely, it's become a game of who has the deepest pockets today. Whoever has the deepest pockets have been able to survive over the last year. Quite a lot of them have fallen by the wayside, not been able to have the required capital. And I'm sure that we're going to see more companies falling by the wayside in the coming months because they don't have capital more than what is required in today's scenario. So even the 20% that was spoken about earlier, to which it has been doled out to the companies is questionable. We need to be able to look at that. Rather than looking at the cup as half full, we need to see that the cup is half empty and how do we fill it? So that if you are able to get each one of these companies on track, that is going to bring back jobs, that is going to encourage the economy, that's going to encourage a lot more development countrywide. I'd really like to see that happening.
Right. I'll take the same question to Mr. Sudhakar Rao. The point that Mr. Arun made about the working capital, that it's true that, you know, MSMEs really need the working capital to get going. So, Mr. Rao, what would you like to say about the challenges that MSMEs are facing right now? And, you know, how can the banks really help them survive? Mr.
Rao. See, the Reserve Bank of India has come out with the Resolution Framework 2.0, RF 2.0. The precisely what it speaks, the resolution framework is, number one, we can elongate the repayment schedule up to 10 years by giving the 2 years moratorium period for both interest as well as the installment. That is number one, so far as the term loans are concerned. That means, for the remaining 2 years also, if suppose there is no considerable profit generation, income generation is not possible, they need not pay the interest, they need not pay the installment. 2 years from now, they can postpone the installments. This is with respect to term loan. I think that will give a great relief. Then coming next question is working capital. See, the working capital, whatever we have already provided, based on the approach and all, might have been vanished completely, or the receive, particularly the working capital components of working capital are stock and book debts. The stock might have been obsolete or some issues, whatever, because of the continuous lockdown and all, might have eroded completely. And the book debts might have been, see, normally we take the period of collection period of up to 90 days and all, we take the for the purpose of BP. But now these 90 days and all will not work during the COVID pandemic. So what we have done, it is called the reassessment of working capital. So we will again afresh reassess the working capital. What is required for this year? What are your projections? And how you are going to, what is your requirement of afresh? It is again reassessment. We do the reassessment again. You forget whatever is there. You reassess and what is required. See, the existing working capital will be carved out as a working capital term loan. That means, suppose I have given you, I just tell you, 1 crore capital working capital limit is there, but the entire 1 crore has gone completely. So for the entire 1 crore, we will give some repayment schedule like a term loan, and that limit will be zero. Now again, today I will reassess your requirement of working capital, and that will be given as the additional dose. So like that, carving out of the existing working capital as working capital term loan, then funded interest on term loan, that is 2 years holiday period, will be given as funded interest of term loan. Then a fresh working capital, again, assessment will be there. It will be assessed. Again, afresh, it will be pumped. A fresh working capital to run again the business. So like this, three things are there. One is reschedulement of your term loan. Then carving out of working capital term loan, existing working capital will be carved out as working capital term loan. Then a fresh reassessment of working capital. See, while assessing the working capital, we have given the for our arriving the DP from 90 days period, debtors period, we have elongated up to 360 days because we know the receivables will be delayed. Whoever is, whether it is the MNC, whether it is government, whoever it is, the delayed period, receivables will be delayed to that extent. So we have extended the period from 90 days to 360 days. Accordingly, the DP will increase and again, working capital can be pumped by the banks. And this is the solution that we have precisely, we are addressing to the MSMEs in this COVID pandemic.
Right. So, Mr. Rao, is the Indian Bank giving working capital loans to the micro segment as well?
Yeah, working capital will be given to all micro, small, medium. And recently we started based on the assessment, various models are there. Tandon and Joe Recovery, turnover method is there, cash flow method. Now we are mostly up to 5 crore based on turnover. Then cash flow method we have introduced. See how the cash flow can be assessed. We can see the GST returns. So whatever is reflected in the GST returns, GST returns are transparent. Every quarter it will be coming. So we will go, we will be, that borrower will be sharing that to us. How much GST return he has, GST he has paid. What is the turnover? So based on that, we will assess the limit. 20% of the GST, whatever sales turnover he has booked, that will be given as a working capital limit without insisting for any balance sheet, etc., etc. This is what we have given. Up to 50 lakhs we have given this model, up to 50 lakhs credit limit it is given without insisting for any balance sheet, any no ratio analysis, nothing is there. Just bring your GST return, show us what is the turnover is happening in that 20% will be given straight away as a, and there is no collaterals also because CGTMSE coverage is available up to 2 crores now, by the way. So up to 50 lakhs, it can be given.
That's a very good initiative, but I want to ask Mr. Balachandran and Mr. Ramesh Babu, you know, what do you see as the, you know, the main survival challenges and the initiatives that Indian Bank is taking? I'm sure other banks will also be considering them, right? Are this really going to help, you know, the people in your association?
I have a different take on this, Mr. Bhattacharya. If you're looking at the balance sheet and funding people, it's very nice. That's good. But in these trying times, I feel that the banks have a bigger role, far from looking at the balance sheet and funding them and giving them longer credit terms and all that. It is going to extend the pain. If you're giving 3 months credit extension and then after 3 months, it is going to be asked for repayment. Ultimately, the money must come from the surplus what the business generates. So I feel they should immediately try and fix up for every company which is coming to them, a financial and a technical expert. I think there are a lot of people who have the technical knowledge in that particular type of industry who have retired from what is undertaking big companies. Even the bank officials who had a lot of experience in this who have retired, make a team of these officials to study that, find out why the business is not making money. Because as he says, he is willing to give for 365 days. But MSME Act says all MSME should be paid within 45 days. So if the money is coming in 45 days, whether it is any public sector undertaking or any other company, TRIDS platform is there. So what is it that is draining the cash? So that has to be studied and he must be counseled. I think because of the pandemic, he has been put under a lot of pressure. He is not looking at what is making money in his company or what is losing. He is trying to somehow run the company because he has to pay salaries. So this is the time when, for example, if I take a few minutes, your cost of material is 60% in your selling price. The material prices have gone up by 30%. We're looking at a middle cost of 78%, 18%, you know, 30% of 60%. And if a margin of profit is only 10% or 12%, every sale that company is going to make a loss of 6%. So if you're going to fund those sort of expansion, I mean, additional limits, you're not going to recover the money even after 3 months or 6 months. So what is it that we can do? We can probably that part of time, look at this orders that they're executing, where it doesn't make money because the whole thing is so big, the material cost cannot be overly controlled. So at least we can grade the orders and find where the losses are more. Get out of those products and tell customers who are not paying on time, you know, that it is not possible for you to supply. Because in such a situation, it is better to shrink rather than to become extinct. That is what I feel. If you do this, you will become extinct. But you can probably shrink at this sort of time and survive so that tomorrow when the things are better, you can revive. So that is one thing that I want to suggest to the banks, that they must have a team, whether it is term financial institutions or the bankers, they should have some people to assist free of cost, because ultimately it is only protecting their lending. The companies do well, they get back the money. Lending on the basis of a balance sheet, or you are saying that you are going to lend 20% of your selling sales. I try to push my sales higher because I want to borrow more, whether the sale is going to make money or not. That is not my concern, because ultimately at the end of the year, I end up with a loss and I ask for more limits. And if you give me more limits, you're only prolonging my pain. The other thing that I want to say is for every company, well, basically I'm a finance man. I always like to say this. Whenever a balance sheet is coming, make a statement of the long-term sources and the long-term uses, the short-term sources and the short-term uses, and make sure the short-term source is not used for a long-term use. So that is really the issue. And every time when I buy a machine, I need 25% margin. If it doesn't come from my long-term source, it comes from my short-term source, whether it's working capital or my creditors, you are ending up with more bank borrowing, funding a long-term use, and you're going to have more liability on your hand, which you cannot service. So the banks have a large role in educating us. Most of the micro and small entrepreneurs, I'm talking again about very small companies, don't have that sort of a financial strength to study or their balance sheet and prepare this sort of thing. That is where I think the banks have a large role. See that this support is given to them, both in terms of technical support and financial support in this pandemic.
Okay. Very good point you make. In fact, there is a different angle that you have presented to this whole debate. Mr. Ramesh Babu, your thoughts on this issue on the survival, that do you agree with Mr. Balachandran?
Yes, Mr. Lalakesh. I fully endorse Balachandran's view. When bankers do assessment of our MSMEs, last year we are in pandemic and COVID wave one. Now we are in COVID wave two. Last year we have lost 30-40% of our business. And then this year also we are going to lose around 30-40% business. This is our assumption. Again, we are going to face, a third wave and all. This year is going to be a big flop to all MSMEs. So here we seek handholding support from bankers, because they have to fully support MSMEs, because we MSMEs are with bankers for long time, say about 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 25 years. So we have our own previous track record. Based on that, they have to design a new formula to this COVID. And then they have to, based on the customer requirement, they have to lend to MSMEs. And this is our humble request to all bankers. Our representation to finance minister also, already we are having 20% as a working capital. This we have requested our honorable finance minister to do it as a 40% working capital during this pandemic situation. These are views from MSME side. So we are fully dependent on bankers. This is the right time for bankers to support MSMEs. So that's it, Mr. Alakesh.
Okay.
Right, Mr. Ramesh Babu. I'll now take the question to Mr. Arun, who spoke at length about the working capital challenges. So, Mr. Arun, how can methods such as TREDS help in meeting working capital challenges of MSMEs? Is it working for Tamil Nadu's MSMEs? Your comments, please.
You, Ms. Pallavi, did you mention about TREDS?
Yeah.
When I talk about TREDS in today's context, all that I can do is smile. Because when you have income, TREDS make sense. When you don't have income, how is TREDS going to make sense? So we are in a situation where there is no income or much reduced income, but still there is a lot of expenses to be met. So TREDS is not going to be supportive of that, because companies cannot meet that kind of business model. I particularly like what Mr. Balachandran said, you have to shrink or otherwise you become extinct. So or even if you want to shrink to reduce your expenditure so that you know you can handle the situation, the policies that are in play today don't allow you to shrink. They don't allow you to retrench your workforce, or they don't allow you to reduce your EB, as I was saying. So TREDS is not going to be supportive of something like this. Mr. Ramesh Babu spoke about 40%. In fact, what I would say is that we should not restrict it. We should find out what each company requires and make that kind of support is provided so that the company ends up scaling. I also get reminded of companies visiting banks these days. And typically what's known is that the RBI guidelines, anything you ask, the RBI guidelines are quoted. We want 3-year profit-making history. We want land collateral. We want personal assets. We want personal guarantee. So the bank's list is very large, and quite a lot of these companies are not going to be able to provide those kinds of or assist those kinds of demands that banks want. So there has to be a combined look, you know, whether it's the RBI as well as the banks together, taking industry into confidence and seeing how everybody can fix this problem. Because we are only looking at this problem from an isolated standpoint. We are not looking at this problem, you know, sitting together and coming up with a solution. As I said earlier, even the 20% that was spoken about during the first wave has not met its requirements. It's not there. There are several countries that have given grants. If you take the developed countries, whether a country like Singapore or Germany or the US, they've given grants to companies so that they can continue employment. And today we've not been able to do that. Perhaps a good reason is because we don't have the kind of resources that other companies have. But at least we can try to see where we can support these companies. Is GST a way of supporting it? Giving them more time to fulfill their GST obligations. Can we refund the income tax dues so that companies get this much needed working capital? If banks are unable to lend, can we get money out of these modes? Can we stop? Yes, the Honorable Minister has spoken about delaying some of the payments. As I said earlier, property taxes also can be delayed on. Whatever can be done from a statutory standpoint to delay so that companies have that money in their hands, that's what we need to do.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Arun. And I will take that question to Mr. Rao. Mr. Arun had a very broad smile when he spoke about TREDS, right? And he gave a long pause before giving the answer, but he has made some very valid points. And there is also a question from the audience, Mr. Rao. So, you know, I'll want you to speak on TREDS and also on this question. Sri Priya Kaushik, who's watching us on Facebook, she says, is Indian Bank encouraging implementation of central government schemes such as CGT SME for MSME, especially startups who don't have collateral to give and no past record? So this person says that in most instances, the scheme is just on paper and most banks still prefer a more established organization to lend. Your views?
Yeah, I just clarify some of the viewpoints raised by our associations here. The term loan and working capital, there are two different products. When we are acquiring any asset, see the term loan repayment will be around 7 to 10 years. So short term use, whatever sir was telling, you know, short term use funds need not be diverted to that. The working capital, finance is totally different. The assessment is different. Whenever you are acquiring any machinery, whenever you are constructing any shed and all, these are all the use of the building and machinery will be more than around 10 years or so. So the loan given for acquiring those assets, the repayment will be really fairly longer period, 7 to 10 years. Sometimes it is beyond 10 years also, based on the life of the equipment. So we need not divert the short-term use, that is working capital. We are financing for working capital exclusively, separately. So that funds you need not divert. Whenever you have any requirement of additional purchase of any equipment, please come to the bank, that your need will be addressed properly. So you need not divert the short-term funds for acquiring the long-term assets. So that is one. So term loan is there, working capital is there. For both, two different schemes are there. Both will be taken care. Then the second is, last year, whatever the 20% and now the 10%, here, this is immediate support given. We bankers never asked give your possessions to sanction the 20%. to give your balance sheets, nothing, no questions. Just whether you are eligible or not as per the Government of India scheme, that is GCLS scheme. 29 to 20, whatever is your fund-based balance, in that 20% has been given. No questions, no assessment, nothing was there. It was given for an immediate relief. Then now this additional 10% also, we are giving those who availed the 20%, they are eligible for 10% also. This is also not for your working capital requirements and all. This is only for your immediate use. Somebody was telling, I have to pay the salaries. Yes, you can use this one to retain your workforce, to retain your employees. So you have to pay some salary. So like that you can use. This 20% and 10% is only like an immediate solution. No questions, no papers will be asked. But this time, what the condition was, it should have been restructured. The account should have been restructured. See, for restructuring, naturally, some projections are required. So here also what we have done, Indian Bank, as rightly somebody was telling, 2021 is a zero year. I think more than 6 to 7 months lockdown and no business happened. Not only MSME, no businesses were happened. So there is no point in asking that 2021 balance sheet and assess the ratios and all. I think nobody will qualify for that. We know that. So that's why what we told, 2021, you don't rely on that balance sheet. You please collect 1920, because at that time there is no COVID pandemic. 1920 was fairly good. You take that balance sheet. What is the sales figure? What are the ratios? Then 21, 22, you take the projections. So how much he will be doing? So our assessment will be on 1920 balance sheet as well as 21, 22 projections. Right. 2021, we are closing our eyes, because if we open, that is a big Pandora box, and no ratios, no balance sheet will support for any additional funding. So this is one clarity I want to give to. Then second is CGT MSE. Yes, we have sanctioned a lot many number of loans under CGT MSE without any collaterals, because I tell all our field level people also, if you take the collateral, in case it becomes NPA, the realization of that collateral will take more time than, let us claim with CGT MSE and get our claim. 75% of the claim we will get, amount of default. That is easy than this. So that's why we encourage CGT MSE and wherever the CGT MSE guarantee coverage is available. Lot of PSB 59 loans we are sanctioning, whatever is coming through the portal, we are sanctioning. So that is one. Then startups, one question has come. Startups, as per the definition of the Government of India has given a definition for startups. So startups who qualify for that definition will be funded by us. Then second is, we have a tie-up with various institutes. So those IIT Madras incubation cells, they are incubating some 270 startups. Indian Institute of Science, they are incubating around 130 startups. Then the Chennai Angels, they are doing around more than 250. So we are asking them to source the applications, because they have already incubated the startups. So those who have got the incubated in those prestigious organizations, we have come out with the IND Springboard. And here the assessment, we don't ask any balance sheet and all. Just we will see whether he got the orders or not. Based on the cash flow, we will sanction the working capital limits. And in case of any term loan for any equipment and all also, we will sanction those startups which are coming through the these organizations. They will sponsor the applications, we will be funding. So initially we started this. In the coming days, we will expand to even other startups which are not being incubated by all these prestigious organizations. So this is and another thing, a lot of support is to be given by the state government. Yes, taxes and all are there. That is all, because that's not in my purview. So in my purview, it's not in the bank's purview. Yes, some state governments have taken, they have postponed the tax. They postponed the collection of the EB for one more year. They have postponed. So these things can be taken up with the state government, and if they support, there will be a lot of solace for the MSMEs. Then second was the cost escalation of the raw materials. Yes, it happened. Across the country, the raw materials, see, whatever orders you have got based on the old pricing, now the entire pricing must have been changed. And definitely, if you execute that order, I don't think MSME will get any profit. So these things we have to take it up with the companies and again and seek for the some higher some escalation. Some 20% higher price can be bargained. It's only case to case basis we have to do. That is MSMEs has to do. And whatever support from the banks, financing part will be definitely taken care by the banks. For so far as the MSMEs are concerned. See, I tell
so,
you,
Mr. Rao, you know, some sir, great initiatives by you. Sorry. Yeah. Please.
Small thing, the our approach towards MSMEs will be, I tell you, I just compare. In our family also, normally, personal front, so many family members will be there. But suppose a minor is also there in the family. So naturally, as a head of the family, you will be more concerned towards your minor, whether it is a male or female. Any mistakes, any small, small errors he will do, we will excuse him. We will support him out of the way also. So like that, MSME is also in the finance front, we will be supporting. We will come down two steps and all, we will be supporting the MSMEs irrespective of their balance sheet ratio. See, if you see for other industries and all, we will insist some ratios. Current ratio should be 1.25. Debt equity ratio should be this much. But for MSMEs, there will be some relaxations will be there. We will not insist the same ratios. Definitely, that approach is there, softer approach is there towards MSMEs. That will continue to be. It's already there. It will continue to be the approach. We will not insist for very strict compliance of the balance sheet, financial parameters and ratio analysis, etc. Definitely, the soft corner is there towards MSMEs.
Thank you, Mr. Rao. And you know, Mr. Balachandran, I will want your views on what Mr. Rao said, especially the talking about the fact that the balance sheet of 2021 is not going to be taken into consideration. It's more the 1920, right, when business was still there and people were still getting their income based on that. But also, Mr. Rao, there are a lot of comments coming in on Facebook about, you know, people wanting to know what cash flow based financing is. So I think there is some scope for you to spread some more awareness about what it is and what are the things to do. And there are some complaints also about, you know, this one from Mr. Ramesh of Alpha Craft, who says he's been a, you know, great Indian bank customer for a long time, but apparently a new proposal is waiting for 6 months for to be heard. So I'm sure there are ways and means that, you know, you're doing some great work and there'll be ways and means by you can reconnect and improve. Mr. Balachandran, you are the finance champion. You tell us a little bit about, you know, what Mr. Rao said. And do you think the measures that he has outlined are going to help MSMEs?
In a very short term, not looking at a balance sheet and funding is good. But it should not be good money being thrown after bad money. So I think ultimately it needs to be studied. That's why I suggested that they need the financial and technical side to do a fact check on the performance of the company. It might be 1 year that they're doing badly, but what has been the situation for the company in the last few years?
Correct.
Then the analysis should be done, and then those units which are promising, which have had a very bad year because of pandemic, because of customers and all that, there are some sections of the business which are dependent on hospitality or air travel or such units which have been totally closed. Those are the companies which might be having a bigger problem.
Yes.
The other companies, I think certainly they should look at the balance sheet, look at what the requirement is, and fund even where it is not backed by any asset, but if it can be recovered. See, ultimately, the bank is funding money from the borrowing it has taken from the fixed depositors. They have a point to answer there. So I think they should look at every balance sheet, at least if not now, a little later, and see the performance of the company over a period of time and encourage people who are suffering for the short term and who can really be revived and recovering the pandemic problems. So I think that is very important for the bank. And for that, I think definitely the financial support is required for most of the micro and small, medium and small units. So that I think the bank should give a serious thought. All banks, I'm not talking about Indian bank, all the banks.
Of course, it's for all the banks.
And one more thing I could think of was the banks.
Right, Mr. Arun, we are coming to you. Let Mr. Balachandran.
One more thing I could think of was many companies, if they have done well, they would have paid income tax. If they paid their income tax, that 30% of their profits, when they have done very badly and they are short of money, I think the government of India through the banks can look at funding the income tax what they have paid in the last 2-3 years Because that's one thing that I think definitely they can be sure of getting it back, because the company has paid tax out of its profits. So definitely in the future also, no company would have made profits for years and then in 1 year makes a loss, it's going to make a loss continuously. The money can be recovered much faster than any other type of loan that the banks look at. So these are the things that I think which will really make the loan effective and also be recovered fast. So these are the areas that the bank should look at. That's one of my points.
Okay, Mr. Arun, you had a point to make. We'll come to Mr. Ramesh Babu after that.
Otherwise, I'll let Mr. Ramesh Babu go ahead and then I'll speak after him.
So we have a different question for Mr. Ramesh Babu. So maybe you can make your point and then we'll come to it.
Okay, so I wanted to add to what Mr. Rao and Mr. Balachandran had mentioned on two points. One is on balance sheet and the second is the CGT MSE scheme. When we talk about balance sheets, I'm very glad Mr. Rao has said that 2020-2021 is a zero year. They would take 2019-20 balance sheet and consider 21-22 projections. What I wanted to say is two things. One is that 21-22 is also going to be a bad year because of the fact that the second wave has come in, and most likely there will be a third wave. Perhaps there might be a fourth wave after that also. So the number of months that we are going to get in terms of hardcore business activity is questionable. We have to be very careful from that point and not restrict to 21-22 projections or try to make a decision on that. The second thing is on what Mr. Balachandran has mentioned. Yes, COVID has certainly made an impact, no doubt about it. It has brought down things drastically. But we've already forgotten, most of us have already forgotten, that even pre-COVID, we were on a downswing. The economy has been on a downswing. Perhaps for 4 or 5 quarters together, maybe more, that this economy has been down. And with that down economy is what we've gone into COVID, which has made matters worse. So while we restrict to 2019-20 balance sheet, we have to give room to see what the prior years have also been. The best solution is perhaps to look at what's the strength of the business. Look at each business by itself. What is the strength of each business? Is it sustainable? Is it something that's going to grow? I agree with Mr. Balachandran. You cannot put bad money or cannot put good money after bad money. We have to be careful there. So it has to be a conscious decision and not one size fit all. The second point is that on the CGT MSE scheme, it's a great scheme. It's a very, very good scheme. And I'm very glad that banks like Indian Bank have been following through on that. But one thing that is biting into the CGT MSE scheme is the charges, the bank fees. There is an annual charge that gets applied year on year, which is difficult for companies to take, especially during these times. It's not a nominal charge, it's quite a large charge. And the second thing is, you can definitely look at lower interest rates. You cannot put these high interest rates on top of MSMEs and ask them to survive that period. So this is something that banks can look at in terms of, you know, either waiving the annual charge or reducing it, or maybe even and also reducing the interest rate that comes along with the CGT MSE scheme.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Arun. I'll take the next question to Mr. Ramesh Babu. Quite obviously, the government has to have a lot of role, in supporting the MSMEs, and they have been doing that. So what really are the expectations of MSMEs, from the Tamil Nadu government, even though the government is doing a lot many things? In terms of policy perspective, what really the government should do more, or what really the MSMEs expect them to do?
See, actually, the priority is vaccination. We have to do vaccination to all workers in our factory. So for that, we have to give priority for vaccination. And then next is the raw material issue. Raw material is a big issue, which is prevailing from last year, September-October. From September-October, it started going up, and then now it is almost double. All the raw materials, you say like steel, copper, aluminium, everything, including paper, it is almost double now. So this is a big problem where both state and central government should intervene, and then policy decision should be taken to control this raw material price hike. And then another thing is, now we are in pandemic situation. The migrant workers who are all here now, 1 month back, they have left to their native places. So now we are in the verge of getting back to our workplace now. So in Coimbatore, from today, some relaxations have given. So now we are doing some homework to get back our migrant workers. The thing is, next 2-3 years is going to be pandemic situation. We are going to be in pandemic situation only. This is our forecast. So in all areas like banking, everything, we need to do both MSMEs, governments should sit together and then draw a plan for next 2-3 years. And then we have to come to a solution. And then this solution should be implemented there and then. It should not be in paper. It should be implemented there and then. Different of a policy, a different plan should be drawn. These are views from MSMEs.
Right. Mr. Ramesh, any other point that you would like to make or anything that you want to add to the other panelists have said? Any other point that you want to make?
Bank, one example, as Alokesh shared, one of our committee member is an active committee member, Mr. Ramesh of AlphaCraft. He's facing a problem. He's with the Indian Bank. So I request Mr. Sudhakar to look into it and then do a favor to Mr. Ramesh, because he's a long-standing customer with Indian Bank and then having a very good track record. So I request Mr. Sudhakar to look into it and then do help him immediately, because he's venturing into a big project. So I request Mr. Sudhakar to look into it.
Sure.
Thank you, Mr. Ramesh.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Ramesh Babu. I'll take the same question to Mr. Balachandran as to what the MSMEs are expecting in terms of a policy perspective from the Tamil Nadu government.
That the expectation from the new government is, I feel this vaccination is all there. Okay, that's something that has to happen. But I think at a larger picture is what I think. The government should look at, whenever they talk of ease of doing business, they're looking at ease of starting business. So all the laws that are being tweaked for getting your registration with GST numbers, with your TDS numbers, with your bank account, everything, it's all good for starting, but what we are looking at ease of running business. That is the essence of the whole thing. The government should look at ease of running business. There should be simpler laws. If you take minimum wages, the classification notification that came from the government on the 5th of March 2019 talks about 148 varieties of, lists of employees from different categories. I don't know. It all needs to be only skilled, semi-skilled, unskilled, maybe. I don't understand how a manager or accountant comes into a minimum wages classification. And if you look at TNPCB, as I told earlier in my opening remarks, the gross fixed assets is based on which they charge the fee. If somebody is renting a place, it goes on 20 years of the lease rental. But if he owns the place, it is only the actual cost, which might be very less. I want to just give an example. There is an act in the US called Paper Reduction Act 1995. And one example is this I-94 immigration form, which is in a single page. They actually want all the applications to be made in a single page. And then this form even says that it takes 16 minutes to complete it. So that is the level of ease of doing business or ease of running business is what they do. And if you have any complaint on that, you can actually refer it back to the government and you can write to them saying how you find this detail being asked in the form is not relevant for that form. So that is what these small and micro industries are looking at. Tweaking of laws to make it simple. Now, there was a proposal to have an act called Small Factories Act, which was supposed to govern 40 employees and less. But you didn't see the light of the day, and then you have this new codes coming in, all three codes, and yet to be introduced in some of the states. But there is no consideration for very small units or micro units, how they will be able to conform all the rules. If you take, for example, in the Factories Act, there is a license for the factory. Then there is a compressor fee, which is a pressure test, which happens to be issued every year and every 2 years for a hydro test. And this law was in 1948. The Factories Act came in 1948 when the pressure vessel was a steam boiler. So that was the reason why they wanted to control that, because there may be an explosion. A compressor is something which, especially at least if you could eliminate less than 10 HP, That should give a lot of relief for small companies. They have to file a separate form for that, pay the fee and get the registration, I mean, license. Every 2 years, you submit for a hydrostatic test. You don't see the reason for this sort of small pinpricks that are added to the small units. So this is what we are looking from the new government, to have a comprehensive view, study all the laws, how it can be tuned for the micro and small units. I'm certain that the boys who are, there was some comment here, boys who are coming from colleges are not going to start any in the industry, because even my own children, when they see me running, doing all this work, they don't want to run this industry. They say, we will keep quiet, you know, we will do something else. So if you want the next generation to take over, or you want the MSME to grow, you are looking at 7 lakh, 10 lakh companies coming in. From who are going to start these companies? It is again these boys and girls who are coming out of college. And I have been telling the government many times that unless you have this sandwich course, where the third and the seventh semester, the boys who are in technical colleges, technical institutes, are seconded to the companies. They have hands-on training. They see what the company manufactures. He gets an idea of what he wants to do. So when he completes his college, he'll be interested in doing something on his own. You teach him for 4 years, ask him to get his GPA at highest level, and then you ask him for a campus recruitment, and you send him off for employment, and then you are looking for many people to start companies. Who will start this? So all the technical colleges for ITI and DME should be converted to sandwich courses, having 1 year practical training in only MSME, not big companies. So the twin objective of training and the employment shortage or the worker shortage of micro units will be addressed. And the boys can be given a subsidy, because there is a rural employment scheme under the Government of India where they are giving for training these boys in the rural areas. The same thing can be extended to the urban areas also. You can have a Mahatma Gandhi urban employment scheme where the government can give 250 rupees per day for any person who has been employed by a tiny sector. The person will pay 350, that means 600 rupees will be paid. And they will be trained also on the job. They will also look at what industry is. Probably it will be kindled in him to start something. That is where the startup will come. We are looking at startup from IITs. I am looking from startups from the small schools and colleges which are...
Smaller technical colleges.
Yes, we are looking at startups at the higher level. I am looking at... And the banks have a big role to fund such startups from the second rung or third rung schools and colleges. That is my take on this. Thank you.
Absolutely. Mr. Arun, I'd like to have your views on this, please. What do you think you have? Yes, Mr. Rao, you have a point to make?
Yeah, 2 points.
Mr. Arun, I'm coming to you after Mr. Rao.
One is the CGT MSE, some charges are higher, like that our sir was talking. See, CGT MSE, we have to pay some premium to the portal. We have to pay. So whatever they are charging, that is being passed on to the customer. In that, bank will not charge any single fee. So that's why the cost may be appearing other than interest, insurance premium will be there. Just like how we pay for life insurance premium and all to insurance company. So CGT MSE also, we have to make the premium to the corporation. So whatever is being charged by the corporation, that will be passed on to the borrower. In that, no profit, no loss. That's all actual charges. So that's why charges may be slightly high where the CGT MSE loans are there. Then second is TREDS. It's a very important platform. It is gaining importance. See, this is an electronic platform. And without any credit limit, see, person need not have any pre-sanctioned credit limit to discount the bills. Just who is maintaining a current account holder, he can just put the bill and any bank can purchase that bills through the TREDS platform. And all it happens through electronic mode. And I tell you, the rate of interest nowadays we are charging for 30 days and 45 days, it is less than 4%. You don't believe that. Less than 4% we are charging on the TREDS platform. Of course, it varies from 6.5 and all, depending on the rating of the company and all. So there are instances less than 4% we are discounting the bills. Of course, for a shorter period, 30 days and all. And immediate liquidity and all. And the government of India also, earlier, there were no compulsions. But now, they have made it compulsory that whoever, whatever is the company, crossed the 500 crore sales turnover, they have to compulsorily onboard all the three TREDS platforms. There are three electronic text platforms available in the country. Compulsorily, if they don't onboard the, all the three platforms, that is non-compliance to that. So that's how the government of India is putting. So now this 500 crores, slowly we are requesting you put it to 100 crores. So that more and more companies have to onboard to the platforms. So when more and more companies are onboarding, then the receivable issue is will be automatically addressed. And for that, you need not have a pre-sanction also not required. Credit sanction is not required. I tell you, our own bank in 2019-20, we discounted 3,900 bills. That is approximately 4,000 number of bills amounting to 547 crores. And during 2021, though pandemic is there, everything is there, we have discounted 9,000 bills, 8,813 bills we have discounted. Amount is 1,221 crores. Even the COVID pandemic. So like that, year after year, it is increasing, it is gaining importance. It is really like a Sanjeevani for all MSMEs. Really, please encourage all your MSMEs to please onboard on these platforms. Because till 31st March, the entry, the cost is also zero. They have made registration cost, they have made zero. If possible, you request the government once again to extend this benefit for another one more year, so that at free of cost, all MSMEs can onboard all these three platforms. So these are all certain tips.
Very good and point, Mr. Rao. I'll come, we are running out of time. We have just about 7-8 minutes to go. I'll come to Mr. Arun for this.
Sir, just 1 minute. One more.
A point to make it quickly. Yes.
Clusters. See, that's what we have started in MSME. See, this is not available for any other sector. For MSMEs, we have started the cluster financing. In the cluster financing, we have reduced the processing charges. We have reduced the rate of interest also. So we have identified across the country around 35 clusters. And in Tamil Nadu also, 6 clusters are there. All are operating very well. I am really happy that to announce that the NPS, see, the entire game revolves around again the NPS. See, the NPS in clusters is hardly 1%. It's hardly 1%, I am telling you. So that's why we are encouraged to pass on more and more benefits. And we are thinking to formulate more and more clusters in Tamil Nadu as well as other states also. So the formation of the cluster will definitely benefit the cost of the credit processing charges. By default, it will be given, powers will be given to the branch managers. So, okay. Thank you for this.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Rao. Mr. Arun, you know, the point on what the government can do, what more the government can do, right, from a small industry perspective, there is also a small, just to put it in your mind, there's a small comment from Mr. Veera Raghavan in the audience. He says that even though we are MSME, our payment terms with customers are 60 days to 90 days. We pay the GST and wait for 2 months to get the GST from customer. So if the GST payment can be linked to customer payments, then we will be relieved of, you know, locking our payment in GST. Maybe, do you think this is a suggestion that can be taken on with the government?
I quickly respond to Mr. Rao as well as add to Mr. Balachandran before I go to the government of Tamil Nadu's points.
Sure.
So Mr. Rao, on the CGT MSE scheme, yes, I completely understand that it is getting paid to the central agency. However, the concern is that the MSME is the one to get impacted. So it's not that Indian Bank is making the money or the central agency is making the money. It's that the individual MSE is getting MSME that's getting affected that we need to be able to address. Talking about Mr. Balachandran, he made a very good point that we have to be able to integrate entrepreneurship into our children right at the college level itself. One of the most important things I'd like to add here is that typically, even after so many decades of companies getting started in India, we still find that our children are single-minded. They are single-function focused. They're only technology-focused or technical-focused. They don't get the overall perspective of running a business. To run a business, you need finance knowledge, you need HR knowledge, you need corporate affairs knowledge, you need quality, and there are so many other things. So this one-year program that Mr. Balachandran said, which is a very good idea, it has to be some kind of a rotational program so that children are able to get a feel of the entire gamut of processing with going into running a business, and that will make it a more sustainable model. Mr. Alokesh, just to add to your point, as I mentioned earlier, just like how the government of Tamil Nadu had done the COVID war room, we would like to recommend that they also do MSME sustenance war room. And this war room, what can it do? I think some of the objectives can be to stop the collapse of MSMEs. That is primarily very important. If there are MSMEs that are collapsing, there are already that are several that are collapsed already. We have to be able to understand this collapse ahead of time and stop that. We have to make sure that the sustenance war room is easily accessible for companies to be able to speak to and approach. This war room has to understand the pain points of these companies, facilitate the much needed working capital loans for these companies to survive, proactively solve these problems that companies might be facing, and certainly transition these MSMEs into the growth model and not just in a sustenance model. Perhaps one other point that I might add is also to look at resurrecting whichever the MSMEs that have already collapsed, because I think that again will add to the economy and jobs. The second thing that the government can look at is engaging large companies. As you rightfully said, the GST question from the audience that came into play, there are multiple instances wherein, thinking about it, that's more a GST problem. I'll come to that a little later. When we look at the government of Tamil Nadu, when we look at large companies, we can mandate that large companies have to be able to purchase 70% from MSMEs. We can also incentivize these purchases and make sure that these large companies are paying the smaller companies within the specified duration of time and not taking extended cycles. That's something that the government can work with large companies to be able to enforce. To talk about the GST point, it's more a central government point, so that's why I was restricting to not talk about it in this context. But because it was asked, let me answer it. In GST, there are several points actually that are hurting. One, of course, is the fact that the payments are not coming on time. But there is a wherewithal for that the government has given companies to be able to withhold GST to vendors who are not making on-time payments. But what we find happening is that companies, especially the large ones, are withholding these payments even to vendors who are making on-time payments. And that is very, very bad. They are hiding behind that ruling, and it has to be looked at. GST, if a company has to pay it on the 20th of the month, then the respective client has to be able to remit that month's GST immediately. But typically we find GST being remitted, you know, the 45 days, 60 days, sometimes even 90 days after the invoice period is due, which is very poor. The second thing is the government, the central government in this case, can definitely look at a situation of staggering GST payments. Rather than making 18%, 18% is perhaps the default rate for quite a lot of products and services. Rather than making this 18% as a one-shot go on the 20th of the month, the government can look at staggering it over a three-month period or a four-month period. So if you stagger it over a three-month period, you only pay 6% this month, and then the second 6% the next month, and then the third 6% the following month. So in this way, companies have more working capital in their hands. Also, we can definitely look at a situation where the government waives all penalties, interest that's charged on not making GST payments on time. So that's my answer on the GST side. Go back on the government of Tamil Nadu side. Definitely, manpower is an area where we can look at the government of Tamil Nadu getting involved. Cottage industries, that is a very, very important area where we are able to engage each one of districts in Tamil Nadu to be able to promote their indigenous products, their handicrafts. To give you a few examples, handlooms, for instance. Of course, all of us know about Kanchipuram, but there are several other parts of Tamil Nadu where there are other kinds of textiles, handlooms that are getting done, which can be promoted. The government can look at pottery, which is another very localized handicraft. Local snacks is also a very good way of engaging people across the districts. We also have to encourage the customer base to be able to buy local. That's a very good initiative as well, rather than, you know, buying imported products or products from elsewhere. If our own people residing here are able to buy our own products, that's in turn an encouraging mode for our manufacturers or vendors who are producing these products. And also the government can play a role in terms of encouraging exports. The Factories Act, as I said, is another area where the government can look at in terms of assisting companies by relaxing several parts of the Factories Act and ensuring that companies are able to sustain this period as well as going forward.
Thank you, Mr. Arun. In fact, we have run out of time. We are supposed to end at 12:45. It's now 12:44. It has been a really very good discussion. I must say it has been one of the very best discussions. Mr. Balachandran, you have raised your hand. Sorry.
I just wanted 1 minute of your time.
Sure, sure.
While I fully endorse Mr. Arun's view that the local industry should be well supported and all that, as I made in my opening remark, there should be a government initiative to get the latest technology in terms of manufacturing. So these clusters, whether it's pottery or whether it's handicrafts, so that the process of manufacturing is improved. Because ultimately, if you want people to buy local, the people are well accessing all the latest products on the internet and they can buy them also. So when they see the fit and finish of whatever product they get from China or even Korea or Taiwan, they expect a similar finish or fit and finish from the local product. So unless you change the technology and you make them much better in terms of manufacturing practices, you're not going to end up selling more just because you say you want people to buy local. It's not going to happen. So I think that should be incorporated into the scheme of things where the government will buy the technical expertise or the knowledge or the machinery, give it to the cluster and improve the production methodology so that the products also meet the aspirations of the younger generation as well as the overseas customer. That's my point on that.
Mr. Ramachandran, Mr. Balachandran, I'm sorry, Mr. Balachandran, you've made such a valid point. And the fact is that we make a lot of good products in India, right? But we, I think, lack a little bit in terms of the aesthetics, in terms of the design sense. And that is why the fit and the finish are not always as good as what we tend to see on the Flipkarts and the Amazons, right, when we are looking for products. So that is an area, definitely, I think the idea of design thinking has to be inculcated at a very young age to all our people, whether they are studying in the technical colleges, whether they are studying in the IITs or the smaller institutes or wherever, even if they are in management, right? Design thinking is absolutely crucial because that is only going to help us make products that can match up to the competition that is there. I am so very happy with this panel discussion because today we have come up with so many practical, ways to go about and try and solve the challenges. There are, of course, it is not an easy path. The banks are doing a lot from their end, but a lot is never going to be enough. You always have to do more, right? And there have to be means by which associations like yourselves and the banks and the governments need to come together and discuss these issues, the issues that you have raised here today. I hope that our audience has enjoyed this discussion. We will, of course, put out a coverage of this in the Economic Times and in the Times of India. The video will be there on Facebook for people to come and watch and absorb the insights later on also. Before I pass on the baton to Sanobar, I would like to request all of you to look into the camera and smile because I want to take a group photo. Okay? Which we will post on LinkedIn. So, 1, 2, 3. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sanobar. Over to you.
Thank you. Please allow me to leave, sir. The other program is almost ready. I request all of you also please join that program where our Nitin Gadkari, sir, is inaugurating that session, Maharashtra MSME Prayatna. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so very much. And before you leave, sir, I want to say this. I think I probably met the coolest banker ever, because every time I interview, someone from the startup world, we always hear stories. They've been made to, visit so many banks, try hard to get all these loans. But it's so lovely to see the kind of initiatives are there at Indian Bank. You want to reach out to entrepreneurs. You're with Chennai Angels, with the IIT Madras Incubation Center. That's phenomenal stuff. So, yes. Thank you for being so awesome. That's all
I want. Once again, thank you.
Thank you all very, very much, dear panelists, for taking time out. Mr. Arun, Mr. Balachandran, Mr. Ramesh Babu, Mr. Rao. Thank you, Sanobar, for your great introduction. And thank you, Pallavi, for being such a great co-moderator. We'll see you all soon. Take care and stay safe.
Absolutely. And I just want to wrap this up by saying we just celebrated International MSME Day, and I take this opportunity to thank small businesses and MSME entrepreneurs who inspire us with their resilience and tenacity. A big thank you to our experts and industry leaders for raising pertinent points on powering our MSMEs to success in Tamil Nadu and to be on par with global standards. Thank you so much for that. And of course, thank you, moderators, for steering this intense discussion and raising the bar. Thank you so much for that. And also, it was lovely to hear, all these amazing ideas, absolutely practical plans. But I won't forget what Mr. Arun said, buy local, whether it's snacks, whether it's pottery. And let me tell you, this entire lockdown has been spent only on eating snacks. So yes, this is going to be something that we all really want. And of course, a big thank you to T.M. Anbarasan, Honorable Minister for Rural Industries, including Cottage Small Industries and Slum Clearance Board, Government of Tamil Nadu, for joining us today and helping us understand how the government will handhold MSMEs through the pandemic and help them bounce back with ready-to-use schemes, incentives, and subsidies. Of course, we all know the Honorable CM and his team are working tirelessly to push the success story of Tamil Nadu to the next level. Also, today would not have been possible. That is, powering growth of MSMEs in Tamil Nadu webinar would not have been possible without our sponsors. A big thank you to our sponsors is what I want to say. This is presented by Tamil Nadu MSME Trade and Investment Promotion Bureau, supported by Indian Bank and Ambattur Industrial Estate Manufacturers Association. And on behalf of the Times of India, thank you so much for joining us today and stay safe.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. Thank you.